How did the niece of the most famous comedian of all times choose audiology? What is audiology? Stay tuned and we'll find out.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program.
I'm Val Jeffrey for The Better Part, and today's guest is a clinical audiologist, Dr. Pamela Von Pinnon. Dr. Pam will teach us about solutions to hearing loss and about hearing aids. She will help us to understand why we should not be afraid of losing our hearing. But she is also going to share some special family moments, because after all, she is the niece of the most famous comedian of all times, Lucille Ball. And you might see a family resemblance. Dr. Pam, thank you for being our guest.
Thank you.
And welcome to The Better Part.
Thank you very much.
Before I get into audiology, I have to ask you about Lucy. What do you remember about her growing up?
I remember that she was a very hard worker. She wasn't afraid to do things that she hadn't done before. She was very creative. The main thing is she wasn't afraid to be silly. And she was just really a caring, wonderful, sweet woman.
So what was it like for you to have a famous aunt like that?
Well, when I was growing up, it didn't occur to me, it didn't really hit me how famous she was, but it's pretty darn special. It's wonderful to have somebody that well-known in your family. And my mother's name was Lucille also, and so when my father married my mother, and her name was Lucille Ball too. So there were two Lucille Balls in the family at that time.
So what happened? You can't have two Lucille Balls.
Well, this was during the I Love Lucy days, and I wasn't there, so I don't remember. But I was told that my mother said to my aunt, "Well, we have the same name. One of us is going to have to change it, and who's that going to be?"
Well, we know who that was. So what did she call herself? She didn't call herself Lucille.
Yeah, Lucy.
Lucy?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Is it right that your dad was a band manager with your Uncle Desi's band?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes, all over the United States, and big job, lot of work. My uncle wasn't home very much. Those were hard times for my aunt because my uncle was on the road the whole time.
Yeah. Had they already met before?
Oh, yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Okay.
And they were married at the time. And my aunt and my uncle really wanted children. And they tried for a long time. He came back, and then after that, they started the I Love Lucy. And they came up with having a child on the show. And that was little Ricky. And but my aunt and my uncle really, really wanted to have children. And finally, my aunt became pregnant with my cousin, Lucy Arnaz, and my other cousin, Desi Arnaz. They named their children right after them.
Did you spend a lot of time together as kids?
Up until school age. In fact, I lived in the Long Long Trailer at my aunt's. There was a movie, The Long Long Trailer,
uh-huh.
And I lived in the Long Long Trailer at my aunt's and uncle's property in the San Fernando Valley, right in the middle of the orange groves. And we lived there for a while on the property. And as I grew up, I would come back for school vacations to see my family in Los Angeles and Beverly Hills. And in the summer, I would make trips. And it was a very different kind of life and really, really fun.
Did you spend much time actually on the set with her?
When I, you know, yes, not much, but some. And I remember when they were filming the I Love Lucy series, they had bleachers for the people to sit in. And my grandmother would always take me to the very top of the bleachers, right under a microphone. This big, long microphone came down from the ceiling. And I saw several of the episodes of I Love Lucy. And if you listen, if you watch an I Love Lucy show, and you listen very carefully, you can hear my grandmother with her laugh in the background, which is kind of a like that. Sorry.
Sorry about the audio, guys.
So I saw the I Love Lucy, and then a little later, she was involved with Robert Stack and some of the other early actors, and I would be in the area watching. It was fascinating.
That's very special to be able to listen to a program and hear a family member who's no longer with you still being part of it. That's very special.
Yes.
Yeah. Did Lucy have a hearing problem? I'm wondering if we can go from Hollywood to ears. Maybe not.
She didn't. I don't think she had a hearing problem. She heard everything. No, she had good hearing.
But your father didn't, did he?
No, my father had some hearing loss. And I inherited that. For so many years, I tried to get my father to wear a hearing aid. I'm an audiologist, and I couldn't get him to take that step. And he finally was so proud. I went to visit him, and he was so proud because in a catalog, he saw a picture of a headband with two hands coming out of the ear, so plastic hands, and he sent away for that. And he wore that for years, and that was his hearing aid. And he was determined he wasn't going to let me fit him with a hearing aid.
Well, yeah. Was it his hearing loss that really motivated you to go into this field?
No. I wanted to be an elementary school teacher, and the major was full and I couldn't get in, and audiology was in the same building at the college. And so I thought, well, I'll just get into audiology and then I'll switch over. They'll get to know me. And then I got into audiology and I got hooked. I loved it.
And that was San Jose State. So tell me a little bit about your time at San Jose State.
So I taught on and off, either part-time or full-time, for about 13 years at San Jose State. And I loved the time with the students. That was those were wonderful days back then.
How many people would you say have hearing loss to one degree or another currently?
You know, I think we're looking at 1 in 10 people. So if there's between us, if there's 10 people in here, I know for sure there's in this group maybe 2 or 3 people. So I have lost too.
Is it mostly older people, though, that have hearing loss?
No. Everybody thinks that you have to, that you get hearing loss when you get older. A lot of people who are older don't have hearing loss, and there's so many people who are in their 20s, 30s, 40s, and 50s who have hearing loss. It's just that we're less afraid to talk about it now, I think.
Right. Explain what an audiologist does.
Audiologists do so many different things. We test hearing, we prescribe and fit hearing aids, we are researchers, we work in the schools as educational audiologists, we teach in college, in the universities, we're in clinics and hospitals, and we work with deaf children. There are so many different areas that an audiologist could specialize in. Mainly we test hearing, and go from there.
How many years have you been doing it now?
37 years.
Wow. So if I came to your office, can you tell me what kind of hearing tests that you would do?
The first thing I would do is test your hearing. I would put earphones on your ears and present some tones, and you would simply push a button or say yes when you hear the tone. And I would say some words to you just to see how your ability to process the word is. I would also test the movement of your eardrum Want to make sure that you don't have fluid behind the eardrum or a hole in the eardrum. Want to make sure you don't need a medical referral. And then if you do need hearing aids, then we talk about that.
So everyone loses their hearing at some particular point in time, and it just gets worse and worse. Should I wait until my hearing loss is really bad before I come to you, or should I seek help before?
That's a very good question. I think that everyone should have a baseline hearing test when they're about 45, I would say, 45 years old. And then if you begin to notice that you're missing things, usually though, it's the spouse that notices before you do. And that is always a good time to go in and get your hearing tested. And it's very important, if you do need hearing aids, not to wait and wait and wait. It just gets harder and harder to adapt to a hearing aid. Plus the fact, if the brain isn't getting that stimulation, then your ability to process those words may decrease, and that can never come back.
I don't know if you've noticed, but all the time you're talking, I can hear you beautifully, but I'm actually looking at your mouth and not into your eyes as much as I should. Is that one of the signs?
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
A little bit, yes.
Oh. Well, I've always thought, well, I don't want to wear a hearing aid. There's a lot of people that don't want to do that. But really, the technology's changed over the years. You look at Queen Victoria, and she's got this great big trumpet in her ear listening to everybody. And right now, the technology is so small, nobody should be afraid of wearing one. Can you kind of take us through the technology a little bit?
Well, the earliest hearing aid was the very large wing chairs, where the side of the chair would come out, uh-huh. and that would capture the sound uh-huh. and send it into the ear canal. And then, of course, we had the horn, which someone would hold up to their ear with a loud, a very big opening on the other end, and then the sound would come through the horn. And then we had the tube, where you see someone holding a little tube here, and that goes out and around. It's a long tube, and someone speaks into the tip of that. Then we went into hearing aids that we used to adjust. Well, actually, we went to body hearing aids, where you wear the hearing aid on your shirt or under your shirt, and you have a wire coming up to your ear. A lot of people remember those. And then we went to hearing aids that were just behind your ear that we adjusted as audiologists and hearing aid dispensers. We adjusted with a screwdriver, actually. Wow. And then we went to digital hearing aids. And we can nowadays fit digital hearing aids with the use of a computer while the hearing aid is in the person's ear. It's really wonderful.
Wow.
The latest, and also we have some very small, tiny little hearing aids that go inside the canal. And the latest is a hearing aid that is placed inside the canal, and you can't even see it.
So you have a couple on the table here. What's this one?
This is the body aid that was very popular in the early days, and where the person would wear the body aid under their shirt, or maybe even in their pocket, and they'd have a wire going up to their ear, and that's the wire, and then that part would go into the patient's ear. And if they wanted to hear out of both ears, they'd have two wires, or they'd have one wire with a Y cord up to each ear. We still do have body aids available, but they're not popular. They work well with very severe to profound hearing losses, depending on the loss.
Well, you would just think we're hip if we have one of those, because all the kids go around
very
with their
retro
little boxes and one in each ear.
That's right, very retro.
Right. But this one right here, this small one that goes inside the ear, tell me about that one.
That's called a completely in the canal hearing aid, and that is placed in the canal, and it goes in a little bit and then a little bit more and a little bit more, and pretty soon you don't see it. And it has a little handle so that you can retrieve it. You take it out every night and put it in the morning.
So you mentioned that you had hearing loss from an early age. You wear a hearing aid?
Yes, I do.
I don't see it.
I'm wearing the hearing aid, the latest hearing aid, that is placed in the ear canal by someone else, and you really can't see it, even with your hair up. It's you leave it in all the time, 24 hours a day, for 2 to 4 months, up to 4 months, and you don't have to change the batteries. It's wonderful.
So 4 months, you can keep it in your ear. What about when you go in the shower? You wear a shower cap? Or
it's water resistant, and you can, but you don't have to. Certainly no swimming, no diving, no skydiving. But it's really as invisible as it gets.
Oh, that was on my to-do list too. So if I need a hearing aid, what kinds of hearing aids would you offer me? I mean, I would love the one in your ear, but maybe my pocketbook won't stretch to that. So what are my options?
You know, a lot of this depends on your audiogram, where your hearing loss is, the severity of your hearing loss. There are 6 or 7 different styles that are available, and then there's, I don't even know, hundreds of hearing aid companies. And depending on your hearing loss, and depending on the style that works for your hearing loss, and depending on your budget, and depending on your needs, what do you do, what's your lifestyle, that would all go into determining what hearing aid would be best for you.
Is it really necessary to have an expensive hearing aid?
No. There are hearing aids, there's a hearing aid for every budget, and for every lifestyle, every situational need. So no, it's not necessary. Of course, there is a difference between entry level and high end hearing aids. If you can afford the top end, by all means, you should purchase that, because you'll have better hearing. It's just much better, works much better than the entry level. But hearing aids work. So many hearing aids work now in background noise, and as we go up the scale in up to premium hearing aids, the background noise is decreased more and more.
How often do I have to come in to have it checked up, to recheck it, and how important is it to do that?
Very important. A lot of people go ahead and purchase hearing aids and try them, decide to keep them, and they don't go back for adjustment. And that's a big mistake. And pretty soon the hearing aid becomes non-functional, and the hearing aid sits in the drawer, and the person has paid a lot of money for this beautiful instrument, and they're not using it. And it's terrible that that happens, because hearing aids can be adjusted. There really isn't anything that can't be worked on or changed or adjusted for the person's hearing.
Well, you say adjusted, but how do you adjust it? How would it change in my ear?
When your hearing is tested, we test different pitches, and we test how much sound is needed for your hearing loss at the various pitches. Depending on the hearing aid level, whether you go entry or premium or somewhere in the middle, it has to do with how many pitches are adjustable in that particular hearing aid. So let's say you were to purchase a premium hearing aid. We would be able to adjust up to 22 different pitches at different levels.
Wow.
And we would be able to adjust for soft sound, medium speech, loud speech, and very loud speech at each pitch. Very sophisticated.
Is the shape of someone's ear a factor in this?
Yes and no. If someone wants a completely in the ear canal, and their ear canal is very small, sometimes that won't work. We can't fit the hearing aid into the canal. But there's always a hearing aid for everybody. There's always something that will work, no matter what size your ear is or shape.
But it can't make the hearing come back. It can't restore normal hearing. So how does the expectation differ from reality?
You know, the problem is that the public wants, I mean, if you're going to pay a lot of money, you want a hearing aid that gives you normal hearing.
Right.
And it's not for sale.
No.
It's not for sale. We can't do that. But if you look at how people do who are successful with hearing aids, what a difference. It's like night and day if they are properly fit and they go back for their maintenance and their adjustments.
There's always been a stigma about hearing aids. I think that's what puts people off the most. What can you say to help someone overcome that?
You know, less and less and less as time goes on, hearing aids are thought of that way. Younger and younger people are wearing hearing aids now. They're becoming just like glasses. It used to be that we didn't want to wear glasses. And so hearing aids are becoming more and more common, especially with the Bluetooth, with the instruments that come out of your ear, like the instruments that come out of your ear. For Bluetooth, people are beginning to accept that kind of thing. And especially since hearing aids are becoming smaller and smaller. A hearing loss is more noticeable than a hearing aid.
I'll remember that. Let's go from ears back to eyes. I think this must be either you or Lucy that stares down on me in your office. Tell me about it.
I placed this above one of our displays towards the ceiling, and it's very obvious, and most people don't notice it. It's an embroidered picture, and it's done so well. And people, once I tell someone who it is, they get it. I think you saw who it was right away.
I absolutely did. And beneath her eyes, your Uncle Desi's eyes,
that's
I believe.
That's right.
Yes. It's uncanny. Your eyes are exactly the same color as Lucy's.
Good.
It's beautiful.
Thank you.
And your hair is the same color too. Is this family trait maybe? Maybe you were Irish? Or?
Well, it's actually a family tradition to buy the bottle of red dye and dye our hair red.
I think back at Lucy, so much pleasure watching the reruns on the TV. And I think my very, very favorite one was the one where she was in the factory making the chocolates and it was going faster and faster and she was picking that and stuffing them in her mouth. That's absolutely priceless. I laugh every time I look at it. Do you have a favorite?
Yes, I do, but I'll tell you, I was there and I remember that being filmed.
Oh my goodness.
And what was the funnier part was what they didn't film and show on the series.
Which was?
Which was she had to keep eating chocolate, and it got to be pretty funny. Ooh. Behind the scenes. But my favorite episode is Vitamita Vegemin. And I was there when they did that, and that's such a funny episode. I love that one. That's my favorite.
Your very favorite. Do you think that she ever realized how popular she was or she is now?
You know, she did. She realized that I Love Lucy went over in a very big way. I think she opened the door to women being more out there. She definitely opened the door to silliness. And but I don't think she ever expected that this long after she passed away that people would still be talking about her.
No.
I don't think she had that idea at all. She was modest.
Is there something you did with your Aunt Lucy which has just stuck with you through the years?
Oh gosh, there's so many things that I could talk about. I'll tell you one thing that happened is I used to call her Susie because I couldn't say Lucy. So until she died, I said Aunt Susie. So anyway, my Aunt Susie called me and asked me if I would like a few pieces of furniture from her New York apartment. And I said, sure, I'll take that. So she said, well, you better make sure you're home on that day and the truck, I'll send the truck with the furniture. So I stayed home from work that day and the truck pulled up. And it was the longest truck I think I had ever seen, and they started unloading the furniture and unloading and unloading. And I was there alone. My husband was at work, and the movers helped me move the main furniture out of the house into the garage, and we put my aunt's furniture in the house in all the rooms. And then my husband came home from work.
What did
to
he
a
say?
Whole new house.
What did he say?
We're divorced.
Oh. He must be the only person in the world that doesn't love Lucy, right?
Well, we changed his environment pretty dramatically. That's for sure.
Oh, my goodness.
It was very funny to me.
How come you got so much of that stuff? She just knew that you loved it and would take care of it?
Yeah. I love her furniture. She used to, she liked gold a lot, and yellow, and maroon, and deep colors. And she had beautiful taste.
Mm. So Desi, your Uncle Desi, was also a big part of your life. What do you remember about him?
My Uncle Desi was like a big teddy bear. He was wonderful to me. One of my earliest memories was swimming in their pool in the San Fernando Valley. And he was the only one. He used to play with me in the pool and go down the slide. And, you know, he was like a little kid. He also would, when I would visit in Del Mar, he would take me to the horse races with he and his friend Jimmy Durante, and so I would go to the horse races with the three of them, and that was a kick. That was a lot of fun.
I hope he didn't teach you to lose too much money.
I don't bet.
Okay, that's good. Pam, this has been really, really special. I thank you so much for sharing your memories and for reassuring me that if I have to wear a hearing aid, it's not that bad.
Oh my gosh, no. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for joining
Thank
us.
Thank you so much.
I'm Val Jeffrey for The Better Part. Thank you for watching, and keep on listening.